This is Circle Takes the Square, and you're getting your fix of Metal Injection.
What's up, guys? Frank here with Circle Takes the Square. Welcome back and congratulations. 8 years after your debut, you guys put out a killer follow-up record. And not only that, but your debut record has been a staple of post-punk. How does that make you guys feel and how does that affect what you do as a band?
Well, I just want to say thank you.
We were a little disconnected from the scene or any kind of reciprocal input when we were working on writing the material for the new record. We were sort of isolated and just working at our own pace. So it's been nice to have that kind of feedback, you know, after a long period of time where we were sort of working outside of the public sphere. So we appreciate, you know, that we can play these shows and still have people eager to see us. It's been amazing.
I couldn't help but notice that the record seems heavier, you know what I mean? Like, is that the introduction of Caleb in there? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think once we started playing with him, in 2007. He came down, he lives in Canada, We kind of started writing, but we went over some old material so we could do a bit of touring before we settled down and just decided it was time to work on the record exclusively. But definitely his influence has brought a heavier, I think, vibe to the band. I think we were kind of going in that direction anyway, too, so it was like it just worked, it clicked in a cool way. So I mean, we typically just kind of do what comes naturally anyway, but we leave the door open to, like, if this doesn't sound completely like stuff we've done in the past, we're cool with going down that path, you know.
I kind of feel too like that during the process of writing, it was like there was a pretty heavy vibe just with what was going on, so I think that kind of was reflected in the music to a certain degree.
And it's not just heavier, it's softer, too.
Actually, that's a good point.
There's a nine-minute acoustic jam at the end of the record.
It goes in all directions.
Took it into your own hands, you put it out on your own label, and through Bandcamp, through Pay What You Want. Was that like an intentional move, or is it did you shop it to labels and it didn't work out?
We didn't shop it to any labels. We decided to take things as they came. So for us, the process was to finish writing the songs before we really thought about releasing it. When the songs were done, it was time to record, so we did that, and we didn't anticipate what our move was going to be, I don't think, until it was time to make that move as far as the label thing went, but we decided just to go for it. I mean,
we work so much on our own timetable anyway, it's hard to be like working within a label structure where they say you have to record in 2 weeks or whatever and gets mixed in a day and then it gets sent out and the artwork is done by some third party or, you know, something like that. So since we wanted to finish it at our own pace and on our own schedule, we kind of decided working for ourselves was the best way to do it.
Like, when you put a lot of yourself into something, it's kind of scary to give it away to somebody else. So
yeah,
I feel that we really put a lot into the record and really wanted to kind of see it through on our own terms.
It was a good exploration of like every step in the process, from the inception of the initial songs to getting that material into the hands of our fans. You know, it was like, it's cool to have that type of sovereignty as a creative entity, because I don't think everybody experiences that. Some people just write songs and then move in, work with producers, and they help them achieve the ends that they're going for. But in our case, it was like hands-on every step of the way. You know, we really started from the ground up. And because of that, it was that much more rewarding. Because, like, to me, when I think about the record, I don't just think about tracking the songs.
Right.
I don't just think about what the packaging looks like. For me, the record is the whole experience from when we first started writing it, you know, to when we were writing it in basically a storage unit in Brunswick, sweating our asses off, to, you know, working on the artwork at the very end and having...
To hear, to supporting it, you know?
Exactly, now to playing the song, to playing the songs live, which is a different vibe too. I mean, it's a different step of the same process, you know, it's an extension of that process. So, so yeah, I mean, it's a big thing to us. It's
And let's talk about this tour for a second. I mean, you guys are touring with, your main support is B. Dolan, this indie rap artist that you guys hand selected. I'm sure that's turning heads. What's the story there with that though?
I met B. Dolan at a Sage Francis show last December. And just started talking to him at the merch booth. And we just started talking about being in bands and stuff like that. I told him I played in a band, and he kind of like thought, oh, really? So we kind of kept in touch, and he just kind of came back to us and said, would it be weird to maybe play some shows together? And we've always been into playing, you know, weird bills. We want to play with bands that sound different from us. And so we said absolutely.
I think stylistically too, like we've always been, I mean, from when we were recording As the Roots Undo, I remember listening to like I guess indie hip hop stuff a lot, because I felt like lyrically the freedom that they had to explore some things that resonated with me as like profoundly personal was really impressive. I felt like they had the liberty to say pretty much anything that they wanted, whereas I felt like there's a lot of inhibition in the sort of the hardcore world, or like the, there's like this kind of political edge or this sort of PC kind of vibe that sometimes closes the door on authentic expression, I think. And I remember hearing, just starting to dig into like the Anti-Con label archives and like just realizing how much freedom those guys were expressing musically, both lyrically and with the music, the production and stuff, and being really influenced by that at an early part of our, you know, mm-hmm. trajectory as a band. And so it's really a really powerful thing to get to watch that every night before we play. And I think that lyrically too, like we're a very lyrically dense band in terms of just the volume of lyrics that we have in our songs and stuff, and we've become kind of known for that. And that's just kind of part of what we do. So again, that's an aspect of hip hop that's really important, you know, the narrative and the lyrical structure and stuff. So so it does make sense stylistically, I think.
Question that a bunch of people asked me to ask you guys is, how long do you think until the next record?
At least 23 years. We put a governor on it. We're not gonna start working until 20 years down the line, I think. No, we intend to get down to business pretty soon on the next chunk of material. So.
When we started writing a lot of the material for Decompositions, we had a lot more that was kind of like hasn't been refined yet, but things we can kind of pull from in the future. So I think we've made a bit of headway on doing future material. So
we generated a lot of raw material for sure during the time when we were out of the public sphere. So yeah, we're excited to get back to it, start tracking stuff.